So I was wondering why I'm here, because Ethereum is a cryptocurrency, but it was inspiring for me to see the diverse community Arm has built around itself and its architectures, because at Ethereum Foundation, we are maintaining a network protocol and trying to build a community around it, both in universities and in companies. And now I'm seeing a concrete example how this can be done. I saw Arm has released some of its architecture specifications in machine-readable forms. My work is in a similar spirit. I will explain what Ethereum is and how it's supposed to be used and what's wrong about it, and later I'll talk about how I'm trying to fix that. Ethereum is known as a cryptocurrency. Yes, it is, but its promise is program execution without trusted administrators. The contemporary life is somehow dictated, dominated by the server-side computation, and the users don't own the physical machines where their data is handled. But these computers, although usually not visible from the user's point of view, they have owners and administrators with physical access to these machines. So will my program be executed unmodified, or my data kept secure from modifications? These are kind of currently under trust. But Ethereum tries to avoid this trusted administrators by using a Bitcoin-like approach to replicate a virtual machine, its program states and the programs all over thousands of nodes worldwide. We are not using distributed consensus algorithms. So to be honest, computer science-wise, one node with Byzantine fault can destroy all good properties and rewrite the history from arbitrary points from the past, but this node has to be rich. Instead of distributed algorithms, we set up a game where if you join the majority, you get some reward. If you are in the minority, you don't, and this kind of induces the majority following behaviors. It's working so far, but I haven't seen a very good theoretical work explaining why it works. There's the worst thing. The majority-minority, it's not about the number of nodes, because, I mean, one person can set up hundreds of nodes on the internet easily. That's not a good way of counting the commitments. So now we are counting majorities by roughly measuring the electricity consumption through GPUs. So the consensus is determined on competitive electricity burning through GPUs, and it's wasteful, and we are not happy, and we are trying to move away from it, but that's not my agenda today. The typical usage is maybe deposits. So there is a program called Ethereum Name Service. It's a name service, like a name resolution service, like DNS. And you can bid for names to obtain a name. When you open an auction, it's a sealed second price auction. And when you win the auction, your deposit will be locked in this program while you have the control over the name. And now it's like, okay, well, some hundreds of thousands of Ether is held for hundreds of thousands of names. Some cryptographers use Ethereum to implement their own voting protocol on top of it, because this protocol required a public bulletin board, public announcement, and they needed a deposit too. The voting scheme has two phases, so all voters needed to go through both phases. If any one voter does the first step but does not perform the second step, you cannot count the tally. You cannot count votes at all. This voting scheme tried to hide who voted for whom. Still, it tried to enable how many votes went to whom, and they needed this lockstep property, and they tried to solve it through deposits. But anyway, this deposit-taking applications are particularly good on Ethereum, I would argue, because otherwise you need to trust a person or a legal entity with the deposits, and you have to worry about the deposit-taking entity going bankrupt or being malicious or whatever. And instead, on Ethereum, you have to trust a program and its execution, a distributed execution. At least you can build programs, but this didn't work out. There is a famous bug called the DAO bug. It was also a contract. It also took deposits. It was an investment club. It had a bug. So somebody started emptying this contract. The loss was vast. 17% of the total existing Ether cryptocurrency was affected. So, well, the promise of Ethereum was execution without administrators, but here many node administrators worked as the administrators, and they actually accepted a protocol change to remedy this situation. Some people didn't accept this, so the whole network split, and it's been split since then. So it was originally a problem in one program, but this affected the whole network protocol and the whole community. So actually, I started this project even before this incident, but after this incident, the Ethereum Foundation hired me. I thought the Ethereum Virtual Machine might be a good formal verification target, because these unstoppable applications sound crazy unless it's proven correct, or maybe if it's designed by hardware engineers who are used to the ASIC process, maybe it's good, but currently, I mean, software developers are spoiled by online updates, and they are not used to the situation where once deployed, your program cannot be modified. And EVM is also an easy machine. And also, there are many different implementations which need to agree to the last bit. So there is some good test cases. So if I define the Ethereum virtual machine for Theorem provers, I can test the definitions. It also has a short spec, 33 pages. Before doing this, I was involved in a hypervisor verification project, but my colleague had some interest DM manuals, and I saw this, the thickness of it, and I wondered if I could translate that to a Theorem prover in a reliable manner. So this 33 pages specification was appealing. It turned out not too hard to formalize. The paper specification of the Ethereum virtual machine, called the yellow paper, is terse, but it uses equations, and I was able to translate that to an ML-like specification language called Lem. Lem is a Cambridge product, by the way. But there were some complexities. I'm trying to explain that. So the Ethereum virtual machine executes something when it sees a signed request, a digitally signed request from an account, and it, the request specifies which program to run. An Ethereum program is called a contract. And when it when that happens, the program counter points to the position zero of the code. The code is just a byte sequence. Most instructions are just one byte, except the push instructions that take some immediate value. Now the first instruction says push 8, so 8 is pushed to the stack. The second one says push FF, and FF is pushed to the stack. The next one is S store. The Ethereum virtual machine, in the Ethereum virtual machine, each account, each program is equipped with a permanent storage, and the program can access it. And now 8 is stored at address 255. This costs roughly 2 cents currently. So far this is easy. The complexity appears in the inter-program communication. So there is an instruction called call that allows one program A to call program B. B can call A as well. And when A calls B and B calls A, there are two concurrent execution frames running in the same program. They are not only running the same program, they also share the storage and the its balance. So there is a quasi-concurrency, and this was the cause of the DAO incident. So in effect, when you are following just one execution frame after a call, your storage might be very different from before the call. That's the most tricky part of the Ethereum virtual machine. I'll talk about it later as well, how I modeled it in the formal environment. But let me explain the wanted properties first, what I want to prove about Ethereum programs. So the simple thing is to prove safety properties. Only the owner of the account can access the fund, or only this kind of callers can alter the storage, or only this kind of callers can decrease the balance. The invalid opcode is never hit, because some compilers encode assertions into this invalid opcode FD. So if you can prove this is never hit on the bytecode, you have effectively proven that the assertion in the source code never fails. But that's not the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal would be proving the game theoretic or cryptographic properties of the program. So as I told you, there is a program that has implemented second price sealed auctions. The game theorists would tell you in this second price sealed auctions, bidding honestly should be the dominant strategy, but does that theorem transfer to the implementation or not? I want to know that. This is part of the reason I'm turning to an interactive theorem prover like Coco or Isabel rather than automatic model checking, because these game theoretic or cryptographic properties can be easily encoded in these interactive theorem provers with high expressivity. This is a work in progress, and that's a part of the reason I split the work in three phases. Phase one is dealing with a single execution frame, a single call. phase two would be Cora Cori interaction, and phase three would be running my model alongside other implementations on the real live main network. In the phase one, I took the view of a single execution frame. I don't precisely model what happens during a call, but to be sound, I have to say after a call, the storage and the balance can be whatever. The machine itself originally is deterministic in every case, but I had to introduce a non-determinism when I cut corners. So during a call instruction, by default, the storage and the balance can change arbitrarily. But with this, I was able to prove something useful anyway, because optionally, you can first stipulate an invariant of your program, and effectively you perform a mathematical induction over the depths of calls. Whatever happens, there can be only finitely many calls during a transaction, and there must be the deepest call, deepest execution frame that doesn't contain any calls. And here you can determine the execution precisely, and then you can prove the invariant on top of it. And for the shallower execution frames, you just assume that the deeper execution frame satisfies the invariant, and then you can say, well, before the call, the invariant was kept, so after the call, the invariant should be kept by the deeper execution frame, and this is the induction step of the mathematical induction. So I cut corners in a reasonable way, I believe. I'll talk about what I proved later. I told you I use LEM. It's a specification language. It is interesting because LEM looks like a programming language, but you cannot execute programs in it. You can just translate programs or properties in LEM into other languages like Hoard or Isabel or OCaml and Coq. LEM to Coq translation doesn't work as effectively as the other translations. Maybe because Hoard and Isabel and LEM are all developed in the same on the same corridor, I would say. I didn't start it with LEM. I first started the project in Coq, but some colleagues of mine recommended Isabel a lot, and I tried it. Yes, my proofs got much shorter in Isabel than in Coq, so I ported my definitions from Coq to Isabel. And there was one person in Sweden called Sami Mekele. He saw me doing that, and he started the LEM version, and yes, the LEM to Isabel translation worked well, so I switched to LEM. So it's kind of trivial to write down the definitions, but I had to test it, and there's some test suites, so I did it. I just did it for one format. I have to do it for other formats as well. Okay, well, the interesting part is the proving. So I can use my definitions in two different ways. One is the off-the-shelf symbolic executor way. Here, instead of taking a concrete value as an input, I take a symbol X as an input. And when I execute a program without a concrete value, eventually I will see stack contents, very complicated stack contents. So instead of one number, I put one expression in the stack. The first 4 bytes of X is equal to blah, 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 negated. That's my stack content. But I can do that in Isabel. it takes some painful amount of time, but it works somehow. The other way is using a separation logic developed by some people in Sydney. Okay, time is over. I can tell you I have a competitor, the last point. Actually, they are using a different framework and they are a little bit ahead of me, so, but this is very encouraging. The code is open, you can try it. Of course, I found many mistakes in the specification as usual. That's all I have. Thank you.